He was a huge inspiration.
He was the Beatles of comedy to me.
You're the reason comedy went from sort of silly, evolving out of vaudevillian to hip, observational, and current. You're the man.
He had no fear.
If I couldn't be that fearless, what's the point?
He changed what it meant to be a comic, kind of this idea of a craft of deconstructing your experience.
How are these?
I kill you!
I transcribed one of Robert Klein's albums, typed it out so I could see what the words looked like.
Marriage is frail and most of them fail, but if you're gay, then you should have the right to be miserable too.
How many people can do stand-up? And he has to show off and sing too.
Be as smart as you can. Don't be afraid to be smart.
My father told me once, you behave yourself. It doesn't pay to be a clown.
Let's hear it one more time for these guys. Let's hear it.
It is Good Friday, isn't it?
That's right, it is Good Friday. Never a better time to mock it. Guys, congratulations on the documentary. As we were just talking about backstage, you've been working on this for a couple of years, so congratulations on finishing it, getting it out
there. Thanks very much. We're glad. It was such a relief to have it out.
Let's talk about how this started, why this started. What made you want to follow Robert? I mean, he's an incredible career, legendary comedian, one of the best, but how did you get to know him and what made you think that he was sort of perfect for a documentary?
I met Robert about almost 20 years ago. I did a story I was working for a newspaper and followed him while he was working on one of his HBO specials, and in the process, we became friends, and I had the idea then, and this is back at the turn of the century, that to do a documentary, because I felt that he was a legend who had really not been remembered or was not known by a whole generation of audiences that did know Richard Pryor and George Carlin. I thought the three of them were the ones who changed comedy at the end of the 60s. He's the one who's still alive and still performing. I wanted to reintroduce him to the audience.
The alive part is questionable. We're not... I apologize for the Good Friday thing.
I love the Good Friday,
the worst day for Jews is Ash Wednesday. They can't, what's that schmutz on your fire? Oh, I'm sorry, it's Ash Wednesday. What's that thing on your Ash Wednesday? You know, and it's a terrible day for Jews. Anyway.
I'm not Jewish, but I do that too on Ash Wednesday.
Yes.
Robert, what did you think when Marshall approached you and said, I want to make a documentary about you, follow you around?
I said, do it, man, do it. I mean, who wouldn't? The idea is, how do you get someone to bankroll it and, you know, to do it. Many of these comedians, all these really great comedians who humble me with their beautiful praise, they've said publicly, many of them, how important it was to their career was my career. And he started with that premise to get them to interview them and to have them say it as a record. And then I felt I better match what they say. So the only real hand I had in the movie, besides being its subject, was to make sure that the material was as good as it could be within, you know, being able to get the rights, some of which, HBO was great about it, of course. I did the first one, and I've done nine of them. So it was nothing but flattering. It was a beautiful.
Nine HBO specials?
I did nine HBO specials.
Including the very first one.
The very first one, 1975.
Do you have a tenth in you? Do you have a tenth in you, ready to go?
No. No, I have plenty in me, but it doesn't seem that that's what this thing is, just the end all. I still work all the time, and you know, I'm doing something with National Geographic now. I'm writing and performing little kind of Andy Rooney pieces for them, kind of work Alan Alda gets, you know, in his later years. It's wonderful work, that kind of thing. And you meet polar bears. But I'm still doing stand-up. I do television. I do a movie every year and a half or so. So I'm 75, and I, you know, when I say that in Florida, there's no applause either, because that doesn't cut anything in that room. You know, when you're working in Florida, everyone is on life support.
Yeah, you're a young man in Florida at 75.
I am. But I work out. I mean, I don't want to be decrepit, but I mean, you know, the alternative is not particularly appealing either. So keep on moving, and they won't catch up with you. I think Satchel Paige said that.
Now, being in front of a camera for a documentary is obviously much different than being in front of the camera when you're performing. Was it difficult for you to not perform? Did you have to get used to having the camera there and sort of just being yourself and let Marshall film whatever was going on?
Well, you know, reality TV, when there's a guy in the Arctic starving, I've got to catch this moose. There are no supermarkets up here. How about the catering service behind the camera? You know, the quinoa and cheese presentation that the crew is having in the Arctic. Yeah, I mean, I could really be natural. They were around, they were unobtrusive. Personal stuff, I love the scene with my sister and my brother-in-law, who has since passed away, was 95. And he died last year. And also Don Rickles is in the movie we got to work together, who just passed away. And that wonderful, wonderful remark at the end. We were shooting something together, Rickles and I, in California. Marshall goes up to him at the end and says, Mr. Rickles, my name is Marshall Fine. I'm doing a documentary about Robert Klein. He says, are you that much in need of money, Marshall? And his head was all, his body was failing him, but his head was right there.
Marshall, what's it like to be insulted by Don Rickles?
Well, it's a dream of a lifetime. Yeah. You know, I mean, I've spent my whole career hoping to someday get spritzed on by Don Rickles, so it was great. And as for Robert and the camera, I can tell you that when we were done, he was looking for the camera afterwards. So he got used to it enough that he wanted it. Where's the camera now when I'm being funny?
Yeah, I have to go to the toilet. Where's the camera? You know, I mean... It did get kind of personal, there was this thing where a massage therapist was working on me that got cut from the movie because of possible lawsuits. Anyway, it was on.
We did include the underwater scene of the older men swimming. We had a young female cinematographer that day, and before we shot, I said, I have to warn you ahead of time, you're going to see more old, wrinkled male flesh tonight than you will ever hope to see.
I call them amphibious Jews, a new species of, you know, they were all swimming in there. And they were my poker guys. You know,
all in pretty good shape for old men. I mean, it's not a warning like that. And then I imagine she got them. She's like, what are you talking about? These guys are in better shape than some of the 25-year-olds I know.
Well, it was funny. I mean, them swimming. And then we were playing poker, and there was a power outage, which was a bit of reality that happened. My $12,000 generator did kick in, you know. I haven't seen a bad word about the film. It makes people feel good. It makes me feel good, that's for sure. It's very funny, and it's not maudlin. I did have a terrible divorce, which I'm over now, and nothing bothers me about it anymore. I had a divorce lawyer. This was like 28 years ago. Charged $350 an hour, smelled money. You know, he was like, he charged for hello. When you got on the phone, you could hear a clock going. And the thing that pissed me off is he stutters, you know, which it could cost a fortune just to find out if papers were served. That's the only truly, a little bit sad that I was married for 16 years and now I've been divorced so many years. Other than that, it's
successfully divorced.
I haven't remarried. Is that what you mean? I don't know. I'm looking.
Good terms?
I'm looking. What?
You mean good terms?
Oh, well, I would hardly call it that.
It was just a bad joke.
Oh.
People have said to me, well, gee, there's, you know, isn't there a dark side to Robert? And really the answer is no. That he is who you see in the movie, that he's this likable guy who goes through life just, you know, enjoying himself and interacting with people. In a way that's funny offstage and onstage.
The supermarket scene I like a lot when I'm shopping, you know, and the butcher and getting him, you've got blood on your hands, you know, like as if I were a cow. And it's silly, but it was sweet, and that's the way I am. I go to the hardware store, and I have a little place in New York, in the city, too. I'm a city boy. I just, you know, I... go along, you know, work is life to me in a way, and I just chose the right profession. 52 years ago, Fred Willard, the great Fred Willard, who's in the movie, and I reported for work at Second City in Chicago, and it's been ever since. I've done nothing else to make a living, And it was a great choice. I've had a wonderful time.
Now, in the 70s, this period of time where all of the comedians that are interviewed in the film say that you revolutionized comedy for them, that you were the Beatles of comedy. Did it feel like that for you at that time? Did you feel like you were doing something that was incredibly different?
I did. My very first Tonight Show in 68, they actually put me on the panel for 2 minutes because they were convinced that what I was doing was so different from what other comedians were doing at the time, that the audience should get to know me for a minute or two, and then I'll do my stand-up.
I should ask, how many appearances have you done on The Tonight Show now at this point? It's like 80
when something. When Johnny Carson retired, including about, maybe 15 guest hosts, about 82 times.
That's insane.
Yeah. And Jay, he was the best, Johnny. I had it. About 40 Lettermans. I just did Colbert for the first time. Colbert wasn't born yet when I did the first Tonight Show. And I did Leno a number of times. Of course, many Della Reese's and Mike Douglas's and people who are all dead. All dead. I hate when they rerun certain things. I saw Hollywood Squares with an all dead panel. It was incredibly depressing, you know? Charlie Weaver for fourth place. Oh my God. And also women I made love to in the movies, dead.
Now you're saying that they put you on the panel because they didn't think that your stand-up was, people would get it?
Soften it a little, get to know him for a minute. It was disastrous. I didn't get any laughs sitting there, but I got up and did a substitute school teacher bit. The point is, like when my son Allie was going to University of Vermont, he said, Pop, I'm really pumped up. I'm going to see Citizen Kane tomorrow, you know, which I consider one of the greatest films of all time. And I said to him, you may not consider it as fantastic because many of those techniques have now been copied that Orson Welles used in 1941. So, I mean, now observational comedy, the way I did it, I wasn't the only observational, person in the world. I mean, there was Woody Allen was not your ordinary comedian. Shelley Berman, Bob Newhart, even Bill Cosby. And by the way, it's only a case of he said, she 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 said. The Daily News, New York Daily News, stole my joke, put it on their headline. That was my joke. I was doing it for months. Although the whole thing is not a joke, it's very, very disgusting.
Now you did. Bill Maher talks about how much he loved your political comedy. There's a little bit of clips in that of you, or in the film of you doing that. How are you handling comedy in the age of these politics right now? Is it even possible to be funny?
I myself have always done political, except Mind Over Matter, my second album, which was full of Watergate, which is what woke up guys like, really got the attention of guys like Stewart and Bill Maher. I always did political comedy that would get a laugh 20 years from now because I knew these HBO specials that I did would be shown over, so anything that's on the headline for a week and you forget about it is no good. You know, like Bill Clinton in this era of really dumb politicians. Bill Clinton, a Rhodes Scholar. From the waist up. From the waist down, he's a high school equivalency diploma, incomplete. Now, unfortunately, that could get a laugh. I won't be around to hear it, but it can get a laugh many years from now. You know what? There's a maudlin time. Election night, after I took my head out of the oven, I reconsidered and realized that it's a great country and a great life. There was an awful lot to make fun of during the campaign. I think that Colbert and Saturday Night Live, which isn't as sharp, but visual and optics and Baldwin and all that stuff, it's so important. And the woman on, what's her name?
Samantha
Bee. Up front, Samantha Bee. If they were doing what they're doing in Egypt or Turkey or Russia or China, they'd be either dead or in jail. So no matter what political persuasion you are, you got to be able to do this freely. And it's most important. And political cartoons and everything go back to our very history. Even George Washington took it from the newspapers. And Jefferson, forget it. Deservedly so. I mean, they denied for years that he had sired people with his slaves and all that. So it's terribly, terribly important. Right now, I'm sort of, you know, laying off. People are kind of nervous, you know. I mention it, you know. I didn't win the Tony. Why? Rigged. Rigged. You know, get a laugh on rigged.
Are you nervous?
A little bit, yes. I was a history of political science student. I'm a citizen. I know how the government works, which most people unfortunately don't, the triad of government. I know about international relations. You can't just push people around in this age. You gotta, you know, you gotta live with what is. And also, I do believe as a student of history that the world was in much worse shape in 1940 when the Nazis held all of Europe and the Japanese held most, if not all, of Asia. There were no atomic bombs yet. And that's something we forget about. You're only reminded of it now. We were in the, which is in the movie, by the way, the take cover drills, the civil defense.
Duck and
you
cover.
Know, excuse me, you're old enough, you know, you're much younger than I, but you, if you are, man, tell me what you're doing. You know what I mean. I don't go that way, you know. I was once sitting behind Guy Lombardo, the band leader. He had three hairs. They were all black and with shoe polish. You know, I can't do it. But, you know, we have to have perspective. These terrorists are 10th century filthy ignoramuses who can do harm and don't care about killing people. But I remind we Americans, our frontier mentality, 35 people a day approximately die from gunshot in this country, suicide, homicide, and accident. And that's a public health thing. If two people die from something, a toy where a kid gets stuck in a crib, we go crazy. But that, you know, you have the right to bear arms. A musket, okay, I'll give you a musket. That's what it's.
Couldn't agree more. Marshall, what was the most difficult part of making the film?
Having the people say, well, you're a film critic. Do you really want to be a movie maker? Because I've been a film critic was for 40 plus years, so.
Is this your first documentary?
I made a documentary a few years ago that didn't get released about Rex Reed, the film critic that played a couple festivals.
It's pretty funny.
Thank you. The toughest thing really was just having the patience to get it all done. That, you know, it's never easy. Every hurdle that you get over and celebrate, ultimately there are two more that you have to get over. And you really need patience and persistence to drag something like this across the finish line, even with as easy a start as we had.
I told him to recuse himself from criticizing the film, but
I gave it a good review anyways.
You know, the duck and cover stuff, not to stick to this, but watching that is, it's not often that you get to see that footage, and I know that it exists, but it almost seems more hopeful where, at that time where people didn't know what nuclear fallout could actually look like.
No, we knew. That's the point. You know, we were given the dog tags with our name on it. I was in PS-94 in the Bronx. I was a little boy in the 50s when the Soviet Union and us both had developed filthy, inaccurate nuclear. They would just blow everything up. And now, of course, they still would blow everything up. But, you know, we were given these dog tags and told that they could withstand 10,000 degrees centigrade of heat. Ooh, you know, children, these dog tags are to be used in the event that you're burnt beyond recognition in a nuclear holocaust. And I want no talking during a nuclear, you know, no talking. No, we were terrified. And they blew a siren. Sirens were the signal. And yet they blew a siren every day at noon. And I thought, what if the Russians attacked at noon? We're going, lunch, boom, you know what I mean? But the fact is, there's no escape. It would be equivalent to the extinction of the dinosaurs. We've been on the Earth a fraction of reptiles and all kinds of mammals. This might be the reason, if not climate change. I hope it doesn't happen the next, what do I have, 5 or 10 years? You know, frankly, I'm selfish. You know what I mean? But one button, one switch. We now have the means to destroy humanity, and it's lurking there, and you're reminded of it because of North Korea. All the other countries behave, you know, they don't mention their nuclear, you know, they don't threaten with it.
What do you think has been the greatest achievement of your career?
This film.
Well, it certainly is a wonderful capper to, you know, how many people get a chance to see the royalty of American comedy paying such tribute. It really is wonderful. It's hard to say. Broadway hit, some good performances in movies. My parents and I sitting in the White House lawn performing for the president. It was President Carter. I performed for President Reagan. I performed for President...
Performed for Reagan?
Yes, at the Ford's Theater. It was a ceremony honoring the Ford's Theater, where Lincoln was shot, but the restoration of it. And he couldn't hear very well, but he was laughing nonetheless. His wife was laughing. And also President Clinton. We went, Bette Midler and I and Morgan Freeman and others went to read a play at the White House. I guess those are accomplishments too. And he was staring at Lolita Davidovich, you know, like, wah, 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 wah. This was before Monica Lewinsky. So he was schnupping away and his wife got blamed for it. That's what I don't understand.
Really, I would say that Robert's career is the accomplishment, that he has done so many things in so many different arenas and had success and managed to keep it going, has never had to have a day job, lives the life that he wants. To me, that's the success.
I'm alive, too, which comedians don't seem to have a tendency to be able to do. It's sad. I mean, you know, there's a thing I'm talking to Seinfeld in the movie, talking about the last time I saw Richard Pryor, who's as great a comedian as I ever saw in person, and he couldn't move and all that, and we took a picture. George, he was between George and I, Carlin, and anyway, you'll see the movie, it's a story. But I mean, I've seen the template. He wasn't very old, but for older comedians, old Henny Youngman who babbled during the day, but he knew his jokes. Really? He could still do a gig, he knew his jokes. Take my wife, please. And you say, what do you want for lunch? So
he could still do his act.
He could still do his act, and then when that stopped. When George Burns died, I wrote two book reviews to the New York Times about him, you know. And shoot me before that happens. He was 100. He had slipped in the bathtub, and he had hit his head. But he had made a recovery, George Burns, and they said there was no reason why his, you know, that he shouldn't be able to perform, but he couldn't. He could no longer, his acuity was gone. He could no longer remember his jokes or his lines. And there he was in a wheelchair cursing the darkness because he blew a gig at the Palladium in London, which had hired him to come on his 100th birthday. You know, there is a time when you go out to pasture, or at stud. I'd like to be at stud. Do they do that with old men? You know, like
perhaps
a racehorse? That's a life for me. Forget the hay. I would prefer better food, but stud would be a good life after my career is over.
Let's talk about Still Can't Stop My Leg, or I Can't Stop My Leg, right? Which you told me that you said that you improvised that, basically.
I improvised almost all my material originally.
Oh, okay. See,
unlike George. George wrote like a playwright. And rewrote like I wrote my book.
Carlin,
yeah. Yes. And then he would try it out, and then he'd rewrite. And my initial impulse comes from my Second City training, improv, you know. I was at the improv at 44th and 9th here, which is no longer around. There is one in L.A. and a couple of others. The only club of its kind. And I'm wailing on my harmonica, the blues, you know, as I want to do. And is that me? Holy smokes. That's scary. That's like that painter who painted with dots.
Surratt.
Holy God. My goodness, that's frightening. Anyway, where was I? I was telling you.
Your leg and
leg.
Improvising
so
it.
I'm you know, wailing on the harmonica, and I'm hitting my foot. And Ray Johnson, this wonderful pianist, who played behind Bette Midler when she was unknown for 3 years till she got it right. He's in Louisville now, retired. Well, he plays at a steakhouse, I think, you know, great, great blues man, jazz man. And I'm wah, 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 wah. And for 2 minutes, no words. And then finally, what do I blurt out? The only thing, I can't stop my leg. And the audience exploded. You know, for a smart comedian, it's a silly joke. But I ended all 9 HBO specials with it in one form or another. We did it in Spanish. No puedo parar mi pierna, with dancers from Cuba and Miami. We did it in a sort of Germanic way. We did it in a Broadway way. And Marshall, you tell them about the title. You decided to name it that.
I figured that.
I think you've heard enough from him. Now. I'm sorry.
I figured that if you knew Robert, you would get the title because you would get the joke of the title. And if you didn't know Robert, you go, well, what the heck is this? This looks interesting. Why can't he stop his leg?
So it was a good title. I think a good, you know.
I think it's a great title. What is it like to have this? I think it's a wonderful bit. It's very silly. It's absurd, and it makes me laugh when I see it. But it's this bit that you say yourself, like, if you're a smart comedian, it's this or that. But then it kind of defines your career eventually. What was that like for you?
Well,
it just becomes your most known bit. It doesn't define your career at all.
A little bit. There are other ones. I can't do it today. My chops aren't there. I do a theremin, like a horror movie thing. But I never had a hook like Rodney. I'll tell you, I don't get no respect at all, okay? You know, he's in the movie big time because...
He tried to... Yeah, you worked very closely with him. Did he try to help you develop a hook or tell you needed one?
He didn't try. I followed him around for 11 years. We were very close. And I went to the Yale Drama School, but they didn't teach stand-up comedy. He was an expert. I mean, and he also wrote his own jokes in those early days, stuff worthy of Art Buchwald and what's his name?
Russell Baker.
Russell Baker, the humorous writer for the Times. You know, I'll tell you, our parks are unsafe, our schools are unsafe, our streets are unsafe, but under our arms we have complete protection. You know what I mean? That's beautiful, and that's smart, and he was great. My main influences. When I really wanted to go make sure that I was a stand-up comedian as well as an actor, were Lenny Bruce, who I never saw in person, but who was sacrificed appropriately on the stage. This guy was crucified, man. He couldn't work. If you listen to his work now, it's so smart, and compared to the profanity today, you know, I'm glad that there's no censorship. You censor with not paying for a ticket or change the channel, but every other word is profanity. When I did The Tonight Show all those times, every word was parsed. They were on with legal in NBC in New York. You couldn't say anything, you know. And also Jonathan Winters. Jonathan Winters was a genius. And just like Rickles, his body had failed him, but his mind, I mean, a thing with Paul Provenza in the green room on Showtime. I spoke at his memorial, which was a great honor. He was a genius because he was a one-man show, you know, noises and faces and not just standing in front of a mic and not just jokes, you know. So
did you ever have a moment with I Can't Stop My Leg where, I mean, you sort of referencing Lenny Bruce, clearly you had an idea of the kind of comic that you wanted to be and you were that comic where, you know, you saw I Can't Stop My Leg take off and you're like, oh, that's going to be the thing that takes off?
No, because... There's a body of work, much of which is in, and there's one bit, you know, we couldn't put in because the Chili Peppers wanted $15,000 for 4 seconds of water. Won't you gotta give it to your mother, you know.
Really?
Yeah, maybe you have to pay $20,000 now. Yeah,
you're in trouble.
Yeah, I mean, when my father, when my father saw me watching Little Richard, he thought that he was losing control. You know, he came from Pat Boone days and Rudy Valley and Bing Crosby. And when he saw wabab lubab la bambo tutti frutti with a very ostentatious gay man from rural Georgia, he went crazy. What is this, a code word with you kids? Tutti frutti? You know, what is this, a code word? Yes, Papa, it is a code word. You got it. Bill, tutti frutti. Harold, tutti frutti. Willie. Tutti frutti, kill parents in their sleep tonight. So when I saw my kid watching the Chili Peppers video, what I got to do, I'll give it to your mother, you know. I was not uncool like my father. I went, what is that, some sort of word, code word with you kids? Whose mother? What are you talking about? It was a good bit. We couldn't use it. You probably can't use it either.
We just did. We're live.
They wanted a lot of money for their... The song, I mean, I think we paid, one of the HBO specials, he had a big budget. You know, this was Harvey Weinstein's company, the Weinstein Company. They do these huge movies. The documentary to them was like, you know, but he had to watch every penny. It wasn't easy.
Let's take some questions from the audience here, right here.
Hey, thank you for being here. My question is for Mr. Klein. Did you have any regrets telling any jokes?
No comment. Next. Yes. One regret that I remember that stands out. I saw it on over a urinal at Sanders Theater in Harvard. I think that's the name of it. I performed in there years ago. And it said, roses are red, violets are blue, I'm schizophrenic, and so am I. I did it on The Tonight Show, and I get two dozen very sincere letters. Number one, saying how they're fans, and you're intelligent, and how could you be so wrong about, well, first of all, what schizophrenia is. That's schizoid. Schizophrenia has nothing to do with a split personality. It is hearing voices. It is not being able to control your behavior. The other one, that families who had people in their families suffering from schizophrenia and how this is hurtful and all. And I wrote to each and every one of them apologizing. So that's an example, you know. I like hitting hard, but I don't want to hurt people's feelings unnecessarily. You know what I mean? If I think someone is vicious, like Larry Craig, the evangelical guy who got caught, the senator from Idaho, trying to have sex with a cop in a men's room in Minneapolis Airport, he gets the gun from me because he's a hypocrite and he made gay people's lives miserable. But other than that, you know.
Next question.
Hey, guys. Thanks for being here. Robert,
thank
my question.
Thank you for being here. Oh, go ahead.
No problem. This is going to be a tough one. But I'm curious, what is the funniest thing that's ever happened to you?
Oh, God. Oh, my goodness. Funniest thing that ever happened to me. It could have been something horrible. I don't know. It is a tough one. Funniest thing that ever happened to me. I don't know. I'll come back to you on that. Like the press secretary of the president. You know. I'll come back to you on that after I visit the...
playing one of those Holocaust centers
where you could buy a Holocaust at a discount.
I heard an interview with a reporter recently who said he never comes back to us. He says this in all the press conferences, and he has never gotten back to any of us on any of this stuff. I think we have time for one more question right here.
Hi, thanks for being here. This question's for Robert as well. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about your experience about being on Broadway.
Oh, that was wonderful. I think I did 6 Broadway shows. Two of them in which I had big roles were gigantic hits. They're playing our song with Lucy Arnaz and a wonderful Sisters Rosenzweig by Wendy Wasting. We started at Lincoln Center. They did such great business. We moved to Broadway to a bigger theater. You know something, theater will never die. There's something about the live experience. I wouldn't want to do it anymore at this stage because you have to show up 8 times a week, say the same lines. I get that thrill of the live audience from my stand-up because I still do maybe 45 appearances a year. It is electric in a place where it was the toughest ticket in town. Saturday night, just, you know, Lovers, and there I am, you know, in the spotlight. Lucy especially, I had been in a few. She was, you know, it's exciting. And theater can never be replaced, ever. Because you're in the same room, it must be custom made, each performance for you. Again, like in a traditional Italian deli, where it's not ready-made. Here's the pastrami, there's the cappuccino, there's the individually. And then you pay $79 for it, if you're at Yankee Stadium. It's exciting, can never be replaced, the live. And that's why all these television stars and movie stars do it, to show that they can. And if they don't claim to have eaten too much sushi, like Jeremy Piven, and get out of their contract,
They usually make it only 3 or 4 months. I didn't have that kind of power. I was in each for a year, and believe me, it had no effect on my life. Saying the same thing. I said it at home. I said it, you know. So. The greatest Broadway, you know.
You do 45 appearances a year still, live shows. Are you still writing and working on and workshopping new material?
Yeah. Every time I go on stage, something new happens. You know, but I don't have the same hunger I did. I've written, you know, out of the 9 HBO specials, 2 were 90 minutes, 4 albums, tons of stuff that never made it into any of them. Always improvising something. I have lots to borrow from, and also a lot of good material that I repeat because it works. And sometimes, you know, I go out there. I don't want to work too hard. I mean, you'll never know. I'm the worst I've ever done. They'll only say wonderful, brilliant. You owe it to an audience to give you 100%. But I don't have the kind of hunger I did when I was younger. I wrote so much at the Improv in the early days. Because the customers were often the same every night. I couldn't do the same stuff every night to these regulars, you know? And Rodney was there, and he used to call it, I'll tell you, you and me, we can back up the truck, you know? That means we could write. We can back up that truck and load it with stuff. Guys then mostly didn't write their own material, or they stole the material, or,
really?
Or they had writers. Oh, my God. Gabe Kaplan, Jackie Vernon used to come, and he had writers. They all had writers in those days.
How could you have a writer as a stand-up when you were just doing shows at the Improv or something like that? I mean, it seems like you wouldn't... Where would you have the finances to have a team of writers?
Jackie Vernon, who was appearing in Ed Sullivan, had money. He had Danny Davis, who was a nasty guy. First guy I ever knew with a shaved head. And I was sitting, sitting having coffee in Lexington Avenue in a coffee shop. A cab went through the window and killed him. Call that lucky. No, guys.
It's not like they were paying these guys fortunes either.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Jack Benny.
Ten bucks a joke.
Jack Benny, writers, they all had writers, you know.
What would they pay, like $10 a joke? $5 a joke?
Well, no, these guys were a little more big time, but money changed hands for material.
You don't see that often anymore. Most stand-ups.
No, most of them. That's correct. That is a trend. Although I was very surprised to know how much Richard Pryor collaborated with that guy.
Paul Mooney.
See, my nouns and names, and he's my assistant for that. He's only a few years younger, but he'll be asking someone else when his turn comes.
Guys,
Paul Mooney, yeah.
Guys, the film is wonderful. Congratulations. Marshall, when can people watch Robert Klein Still Can't Stop His Leg?
It is on Starz On Demand, Starz and the Starz app. So anytime they want, they can track it down and find it and watch it.
They also have it scheduled, I think.
And yeah, and it's going to be showing several times during the month of April on Starz and into the future.
Guys, the film is called Robert Klein Still Can't Stop His Leg. It's on Starz. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.